Good afternoon. My name's Rudy Page, Reggae Global and Culture on Fresh FM Radio London. We're very pleased today to be part of International Reggae Day 2021. And I'd like to hand over straight over to Kwaku.
Thank you very much, Rudy, for convening this Zoom meeting. Much, much appreciated. And also for supporting International Reggae Day. As I said, my name is Kwaku from BritishBlackMusic.com, Black Music Congress. And in although our organization has supported reggae, we've given awards to people before we knew about International Reggae Day. In 2017, I recognized that there was this thing called International Reggae Day. We did an event at University of Westminster. We got in touch with the organizers and said, there isn't much happening in the UK. And I was rather surprised because this event has been going for about 20 years. 2019, we marked our 25th anniversary. We had a nice spread in the Jamaican Gleaner and RD supplement. So I got in touch with them and said, look, we'd like to promote this as best as we can in the UK. So consequently, since 2017, we've done the annual International Reggae Day. So 2017, University of Westminster, 2018, London University Institute of Education, 2019, Goldsmiths University, and we're planning on going to Goldsmiths University because we've got a great space, big theaters, atrium, and then COVID hit us, so we had to go online. So as a consequence, we did 2020 online, and this year, 2021, we're still online. What can I say? We are focused this year on what we call International Reggae Day London because the idea is for towns and cities to have our programs. So what we're doing is officially known as International Reggae Day London, though I, as part of British Black Music Month, BritishBlackMusic.com, look after International Reggae Day in the UK. And I'm glad that we had the chance to speak a bit about sickle cell because you say, what has sickle cell got to do with reggae? First of all, as Rudy, you know, and I do know you promote the UN initiative, which is International Decade for People of African Descent. Sickle cell affects Africans more than any race. I think probably the Mediterranean people get it, and I would imagine maybe Latin Americans, but it's not common within European society, for example. So our music is part of our society. Our society is part of our music. So it's just as legitimate to talk about sickle cells whilst we're talking about reggae. And what I liked about the ethos behind International Reggae Day, and I have to give shout out to Jamaica, because it's a Jamaican initiative. So RRD Jamaica is our headquarters, they brought together, is that the lady behind it is into the environment. For example, she also encourages people to plant a tree in International Reggae Day. And we took that on board, I think 2018, I'm sure Dan will correct me if I'm mistaken. I think if I'm mistaken, please correct me. I think in 2018, we planted a tree in Houston and it's there. And we hope the community will sort of rally around to make it great, but I'll leave that bit to Dan. So in a nutshell, we're doing everything online. More importantly, we've got conferences. In fact, I guess people are gonna say, why are you investing, investing, investing? I know that music is often in the community spaces, but what I also found about International Reggae Day was that they had conferences. In fact, they've done things about intellectual property. That's, and I think it's great to do the music, but you must understand the business side of it, the legal side of it. And I come from a legal background. I'm not a lawyer. I've got an LLM in entertainment law because I teach music industry. So I put it into the university spaces so we can look at reggae from a different perspective. That doesn't mean that people from the community couldn't come, but I wanted to deliberately, and I do things in community centers. Dan knows we do things in Tavistock Hall and stuff. So we should be everywhere. And I deliberately wanted to put it in those university spaces. So that's why we did. But it's accessible, if you understand. And so this year, for example, we've got conferences. We're looking at the influence of Britain on reggae music because it's not a one-way street. Reggae from Jamaica's influenced us, but we've also influenced them. We're also looking at the way reggae has influenced British pop music. Someone's reminding me, rave, jungle, drum and bass. So this is the type of things we're going to talk about. Then, as I said, reggae music. In fact, one of the reasons why they won the UNESCO, I always forget about, they've got something. Jamaica now has reggae as a mark for intellectual blah 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 heritage. You can go and find out. By the way, it was a point that it was the voice or the voices of the marginalized. So we're also looking at how reggae has impacted on British society. If you remember, one of the milestones that we're marking this year is the 40th anniversary of the New Cross Fire and the Black People's Day of Action. So reggae speaks to that. Those that were on the march or those that have seen Menelik Shabazz's video, Black Agoran, would know that one of the tracks played is something that said 13 dead, nothing said. And although the artist on the record is Johnny Osborne, who's a Jamaican, it was recorded in England. It was produced by Aswad and Mikey Campbell, who, by the way, Mikey Campbell is an RRD award winner. The other thing we'll be looking at, and I think most people on this platform or your listeners may not be aware of, is something called BRAFA. BRAFA stands for British Reggae Artist Famine Appeal. Everybody remembers 1984, 1985, Bob Geldof and Band Aid and getting money for the Ethiopian famine relief. But few people realize that the reggae community came together to record a track called Make Africa Green Again. They did a one-off concert. Leon of Blackstones tells me that they had PA systems. Maybe Fizra, you should have been there to help them. So some of the artists on the bill didn't get to play, but at least they made an effort. So we know of Live Aid, Band Aid, but the reggae artists 38 years ago came together. So that'll be part of our conferences. Then we have DJ sets, we have performance, and I think I've spoken enough, so maybe Dan can talk about the reggae tree.
Right. So, Kweku, thank you very much for that. And there's some key points that you mentioned that are really important. And it's pleasing that you do put reggae in a university setting and a learning setting, because that helps give clarity and definition to the culture and to what people are doing, what practitioners are doing, because then you can build on that when you've got clarity and definition. And of course, culture and our ability to utilize culture and then to understand how to translate that into economic value
Indeed.
is important, because we're now in the age when we talk about the 21st century skills, collaboration, communication, creativity, critical thinking, and they're the skills that you need for what we now call the creative economy. And again, it's a translation of your ideas, addressing the issues that are in your local community, in your environment. And reggae is important when it comes to mental health and spiritual well-being. Our colleague Beresford Dawkins, who works for Mental Health Trust in the Midlands, has done a lot of work on that, and bordering on the gospel reggae as well. And he has a great theme, why should the devil have all the good music, to show that reggae does belong in the church and in faith communities, along with all other types of music. That's really important. So I think what you're doing is excellent, and we certainly want to be a part of that. So let me go
Could
to,
I just
yes.
make a quick point? First of all, I have to plug, because I've said a lot about everything is on the website, which is bbm.eventbrite.com, bbm.eventbrite.com, or else irduk.co.uk, irduk.co.uk. There was one
Right.
thing else I wanted to say, and I will come back from what you said, so I will come back on that
No
later.
problem. Okay, Diane.
Hi, so Kwaku is back in 2018. So I met you on the 1st of July 2018. I remember it was a Sunday morning, 9 o'clock. So Councillor Lloyd McLeish, she's not on here, he told me about a tree that was being planted. And I went down, and it was before my church service, 10:30 that was. And that's when I met you. And I was invited into the picture by Dawn Butler. He said, oh, you can't be wearing pink and not be in our picture. And so there it was. That's where the story began. And I remember mentioning about Roots FM. And I remember you said that you were already connected with them. But because of the ideas that I had, that's how you got me involved. And I've been in contact with you ever since. And so it's been an honor, and I've learned a lot from you. So I want to say thank you to you, Kwaku, because I grew up on reggae music. Like I said, my dad lived at 31 Maxfield Avenue, right by Channel One Studio. Mum lived at 32, all the way down the other side. And my mum always used to say, listen to the words of music. And having, you know, my mum, my husband and my dad depart in 2018, music has kept me going. I hardly have the TV on. And reggae music in particular has kept me going. In particular, my mum used to say, you know, when she used to say, listen to the words of music, it was Bob Marley. She loved all sorts of music, but Bob Marley, the words, conscious lyrics. So it is an honour, you know, and music has connected me with Rudy and Donna. And Donna our story is powerful. We'll be here all day if we were to tell you. But we haven't met, but we're twin sisters. But we met through music, because I was also a storyteller for the Borough of Culture, No Base Like Home. Okay. So that's how I was given Rudy's contact.
That's right.
And Donna's. So music has brought us together.
Brought us together. Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. The power of music. And I just want to touch on the church. You know, so I grew up in church as well. So I can tell you, we have in Brent, St. Michael's in Brent, we have a church called St. Michael's in Tokington. And before that Sunday morning service, Father Stuart Melcher, who is the vicar, he was licensed this year. So on a Sunday morning, he plays reggae gospel before his church service starts. Yeah, so St. Michael's in Tokington, yeah, reggae music. So Kwaku, that tree now, the story of the tree.
Yes.
So 1 year on, in 2019, so we met around that tree again, and we had Carol Thompson, Janet Kay, Victoria Mary Evans, and people from the council and officials and people from the community. So we had a bit of a celebration. A plaque was placed there, which we, bit very small, and placed at the bottom of the tree.
It's a start, though. You start.
Yeah, it's a start. So we embrace it. And that's what I say to people. You know, I kept on saying to people about the red, because I'm proud that we've got starting point.
Yeah.
So we give thanks.
Yeah.
So, and I thank you for initiating it. And then we had a celebration at the Tavistock, and Big Brother Fitz was involved there. Pat, who's a singer, who's from Harlesden, I was hoping she'd be here, but I'm trying to get her involved on the 1st of July. So the story of that tree, the story has begun.
Right.
We just got to build on that story. So we need to get, so obviously COVID, we couldn't do anything last year. So the tree's looking a bit.
Yeah, we'll get there.
Need some love.
Everything is work in progress.
Absolutely.
And one step at a time, then you just keep building from there.
That's right. So we've begun, and so we want to, you know, give that tree some love, we'll get there. We have a short term plan, but we've also got the long term plan.
Yeah.
And thank you for letting me lead on the tree, because I keep talking to you about the tree. I keep saying, Kwaku, we got to work on that tree. So together we will, and we are.
So, right. Yeah. Excellent. Can I jump in there again and say, Dan has been very enthusiastic about the tree, and she remembers even more than I do. She's always got ideas, are phoning me, blah, blah, blah. And one thing she wanted was to light it with the lights. If you don't know Houston, around Christmas, and I think maybe Diwali as well, they had the lights, the colored lights. And she thinks the tree should have at least something to light up the place. So she's just a bag of enthusiasm. But I have to say to you right now, Dan, I did not realize the sacrifice you made, in the sense that you had to go to church. Okay, church hadn't started, but you made an effort to come to the tree function before going to church. Because Dan is a serious Christian woman, you know.
She's
also very much involved in the church. So I think it's an honor that you schedule the regular tree before going to church. I appreciate it. But I want to jump in. Rudy, you said something, culture and monetization. Mm-hmm. So as part of the dialogue, a year or two ago, Jamaica got what is called the UNESCO Intangible Cultural Heritage for
Yes, that's
reggae.
right. Yeah.
We had so last year, no, it couldn't be last year, 2019, we had one of the guys that work at JIPO, that's Jamaican Intellectual Property Office,
Yeah.
come to talk about the whole process. But I think they're missing a trick, how to monetize it. That award does not automatically monetize. It's just an honor that says Jamaica comes from Jamaica. So reggae comes from Jamaica. Or as Dean, I might say, no, reggae comes from Africa, but sort of through Jamaica, if you understand what I'm
Yeah,
saying.
that's
So,
that is a debate on itself, which debate we haven't got a lot of time
But
for.
what I'll say is that since you're very much involved in Jamaica and the cultural thing, I think it might be helpful to link them up and see how you can monetize that award from the UNESCO.
And I'll take that on board. It's a great point because also what we did this year as part of our Reggae Global and Culture linked with Reggae Month Jamaica, we had Hugh Harris. Sorry, Hugh Francis,
Francis.
who spoke about reggae, what is reggae, and the business of reggae. And also on World Intellectual Property Day, which was on the 26th of April, he spoke about the 21st century black music industry. And of course, his track record with Jetstar. So he really knows when it comes about the translation of culture, music into economic value. So we've got two great talks for him from him that will actually, be on International Reggae Day this year as well.
Right, I don't think I've got the link. Did you send the link? Because I did ask for it.
Well, I'll make sure you got it. You'll get it
Thank
today,
you.
even if you
Thank
haven't got
you.
it.
Thank you.
Right, we mentioned
Sorry, do
before.
you mind
Okay. Yes,
I was
Donna.
just going to say, sorry for just butting in, but just to say, I think it's an amazing idea, the tree, and I just think it just couldn't be in a better place. I mean, I grew up in Harsden and came from a very musical family, and it's just lovely to know the tree is literally near where I grew up, my doorstep. So
Excellent.
yeah, it's just nice, and I hope it grows and it flourishes and more people get involved. And if it wasn't for Diane, I wouldn't even know about the tree. So thanks to Diane, my twin sister, who I've never met. It
So Donna
is
then,
hard to understand, but
Donna,
sorry.
so does that mean now we're gonna be able to get a song sung by you about the reggae tree in Harlesden?
Well, yes, I'm going to have to work on that
Excellent, excellent. Right.
one.
We'll come
I'll have to
back to you
work on that one.
definitely. Right.
I need to see the tree, though. I need to see what it even looks like, So, I mean, I have no idea. So, yeah, but it sounds good to me.
It can be
It's a great
arranged.
idea.
Right. The two fantastic words as it relates to reggae for me, sound system. So Fitz, you couldn't be on here and not talk about sound system. I mean, since 1974, when I started going out all the time, showing my age now, that sound systems, the way the guys used to string it up and that bass when it started, God only knows how they knew all those wires when a speaker box went and the lights came on and everybody's glaring across to the to the unit, wondering when that music's going to come back. Tell us about the sound system.
We
Wow.
started out 19, I think it probably was about early, very, very early 80s. We started out, a group of friends had just got together. And I started out as a mic man at first when we started. I was on the mic and used to make noise and G up the people. And it's a thing where, how can I put it now? It was like a coming together of sorts because everybody was doing something different. But when you came together to do this particular thing, everybody was on the same page. There was no talking, no meetings, no, oh well, you're gonna be doing this. Everybody came and knew what they were
Team,
doing.
teamwork. So
You
that's great
understand?
teamwork without the theory, just
And
practical.
it was a set of madness because I remember we had the Quad 18s. Jesus Christ, man. How we moved them, I couldn't tell you. But we moved them, right? You're talking about 18-inch. I'm looking at my washing machine now, and 18-inch speaker, the front of it is about the same size as the front of the washing machine.
That's right.
Now imagine a box the size of your wardrobe with four loads in. Now, how we moved them, I don't know. But
you were young men those days.
Well, there you go. And in my years in transport, because I'm also a fleet manager and I've been in transport for a lot of years now, I could tell you we've had bread vehicles. I was driving for a bread company, so the sound has traveled in bread vehicles. The sound I was working for, I was transport manager for Currys, so the sound has traveled in Currys, like Currys trucks up and down the road. All right, I'll say it now because I'm not working here no more. All right, DHL, we've had DHL vehicles up and down the roads, furniture trucks. But what people don't actually realize is that the life that you live as a soundman is completely different to the life you're going to live as a raver. Because remember, our party, our dance starts before you even have your bath. We got to be there first and set up. Mm-hmm. And then we all enjoy it. And hear what? You see, when you're walking out now, you're getting your coat from the cloakroom. Our night ain't finished. You understand what I'm saying? We got to be unpacking and taking this home and blah, blah, blah. We played at Nottingham Carnival we did 24 years at Nottingham Carnival. We're not there anymore. I stopped doing Carnival because it's a politics thing. Carnival is not Carnival no more. That's how I see it. Yeah. But we were there 20 odd years and we had a wicked, wicked, wicked time. We saw Carnival grow. You know what I mean? And it's been taken over by other people.
Yeah.
I'll just leave that there because that's for a different argument. But the sound system now, where the sound system is now is it's no longer, you still got a couple of guys out there like Ras Mikey and Debla who are still running the big sounds. Mm. But because there is no way to play the big sounds anymore, you can't get the community centers no more. Mm-hmm. You can't get the halls no more. They don't want you to bring this equipment in there. Mm-hmm. So the sounds have got smaller. But the funniest thing now, due to technology, the sounds are getting smaller, but technology now, you're still getting the same oomph for your pound.
Yeah,
you know what absolutely. I'm saying? So whereas I used to have to pack up a van, now in the back of my Range Rover, I could put some stuff in there that will still come and shake down the dirt in your house. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, I mean, even Alexa can play some bass.
Oh, mate, there you go, mate. So we're still running that way, but we're still fighting.
Exactly.
As a soundman, we're still fighting that fight.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then you've got the DJ thing now. Man's walking up and down with laptops and all this and that and rare. But we're still there. We old school and we're still there. And thank God we have there are some youngers out there who are taking it up now as well. You know what I mean?
And in fact, you're kind of underlining the point that Owen Winter, DJ Black as he's called, who's the founder of Fresh FM Radio London, makes in terms of the importance of the DJs and them supporting the music. So for another program, we'll actually visit that because there's some great insight in terms of the importance of the DJs and the sound systems, to the importance of them to the ecosystem. And
of course. You know,
and now that we're talking about the economic value of the industry is huge.
Yeah.
It's definitely something to put on the table. So thanks for that. And
the other thing, let me just put this in there.
Yeah.
You don't even know people are your friends until they find out that you got a sound. This is why I sound like I got some like friend.
That's right.
We call them acquaintances, yeah?
Yeah, absolutely. I look forward to us going deeper into that sort of
topic. That'll be a good conversation.
Yeah, right. All right, going back now to Reggae Global and Culture this year, we had two key initiatives. So one of them I'd like to talk about first, and that was Women in Reggae. So I'm going to bring Antoinette in here. And what we felt was it was important as part of our Reggae Month to have women in Reggae. And the focus, and we did focus on 25 artists across the whole month. So Antoinette was involved with that and helped to facilitate that as well. So, Antoinette.
So, good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks, Rudy. And I'm really enjoying being a part of this discussion. I can remember separately, before I talk about working with Rudy on Reggae Global, my dad used to be a reggae events promoter. And I can recall every week we had to drive from Brixton down to Jetstar in Harsden to get various music to be ahead of the curve. Dad wanted the up-to-date music there. And he used to also hold parties at Bridge Park Complex. But again, I'd love to be a part of that discussion on DJs. But my talk today to share with you all, I currently work with a group in Jamaica. So I'm one of the co-management for an aspiring artist. Her name is Yeza. She's a female conscious reggae singer, and she's based in Kingston with a passion to share and celebrate world reggae. So Rudy and I met through a variety of our community programs, and Yeza was introduced to Rudy because her tracks are very African-centric at the moment. So we do a lot of social justice material. So she's very keen to ensure her words, her legacy, her heritage is transmitted through her music. So we have a track that have been circulating back in 2019, but became more prevalent, sadly, with the death of George Floyd. So Yeza has a track out called Is It Because I'm Black? And the lyrics are so pertinent to us all for world Black history. The things that we go through, things that impact us on a local level and also on a regional, then international level. So we discussed with Rudy, how could we showcase women's impact and influence in the reggae sector? And that's how we came together. We met with Rudy, that's Yeza and myself and the team, and we did a piece around Yeza and her work. So we know we're really appreciative of Rudy enabling us to be a part of Reggae Global Culture. At the same time, Yeza has taken part 2 years now in Yeza's taken part in Reggae Month on the ground as well in Jamaica. And she was featured as part of the Children of Icons. And she did a set of the legendary Dennis Brown's tracks. So it was really, really great that she is taking her work through the decades, but also homage to legends. So just wanted to share, you know, the next generation coming through in the music, it's fantastic that they are holding on to the legacy, but also evolving it. And I think that then in part to Kweko's conversation and Rudy on the creative economy, they are now taking it through the business lens and also the impactual lens of the work. So I'm really excited as a female in reggae. She's seen this, you know, those opportunities, and she's going for it.
Yeah. And what I like about her as well, she's empowered and, you know, takes the lead. And even we did an interview with Coffee as well. Yeah. And she was really great, professional, answered all the questions, and was just really down to earth. So she was. So again, there's always hope in every generation anyway, regardless of what anybody says. Especially with our community, you know, the talent's always there through the generations. It was there before we got here, and it'll be there after we've done our bit. So thanks for that, Antoinette. There's one thing I should add as well. A few years ago, I actually met Junior Lincoln, and he told me about all the work that he did prior to Live Aid, which was quite a significant amount of work. And I was able to link him with Jack Bueller. And, you know, Jack Bueller does the plaques, the blue plaques and things like that, and the black plaques. So to ensure that Junior Lincoln's role within all of that historic times was part of that. And Antoinette actually did an interview with him as well, which I think we'll play some of that on July the 1st as well. So thanks for that, Antoinette.
Thank you.
Right. So the other element of the... Reggae Month Jamaica now, I touched on with Diane, and it's with our friend from across the sea, Dean Roden, and that was Reggae Hermitage. So when we launched the Reggae Month Jamaica in collaboration with Reggae Hermitage, Dean was responsible for putting that together. So Dean, if you'd just like to talk us through about Hermitage and its reggae history and your role within that for the next 5 minutes or so.
Oh, thank you very much, His Excellency, Sir Honorable Rudy. That's how we give people name in Hermitage. You know, reggae, this is his new reggae name now. Now, we must recognize our people, you know, and it's a pleasure being here this morning. As you know, we are at a 5 hour behind you guys. Normally, the first thing I do in the morning is to worship with my mom. So I want to keep that tradition. I was hospitalized for over a year. So the first thing I do is worship. So before I came on, I have to worship. So I have to wake up an extra hour. And my mom said, don't. So I have to worship with her. Now I worship by myself. And after the program, I just called my sister, said, I'm a little late. I want to read off the Bible. We started Genesis and we are now in Acts. So can you imagine over a year, every morning we read the Bible. So just want to just include that. Mm-hmm. I mean, Rudy, I don't know, it's going to take me maybe a year or two to talk about Hermitage. Because of the time, I'm so glad to be here. You know, the missing puzzle that I wanted, I need a contact of everyone here. You know, my friend in Africa. Okay, my name is Dean Roden, and my great-great-grandparents was originally from Africa. Then we moved to Jamaica. You know, we moved to Jamaica at Hermitage, and then I'm now in Connecticut. And I've just been adopted by Arden in England. So I have to work on my British accent. I've been newly adopted. You know, Rudy's now my brother, so I'm a British, Jamaican, American, African originally. And earlier on, I just want to touch something about reggae. We don't need to have a conference. Reggae was originated in Jamaica, but it is related to Africa. There's no debate about it. Africa, reggae music focus straight about Africa. You know, whether it is in gospel or it's related to what we have been through coming from Africa. So 90% of the songs they sing, it's about Africa. And what I'm saying today, you will never get it downloaded. This information, I was there. You know, I've been living in Hermitage from 64. And when you talk about culture, the first cultural day was kept in Hermitage. And that's where we're going to, for Diane, that's where we're going to plant the reggae tree. I'm going to pass it around to Augustown, Goldsmith Villa. So I have a committee with all the members of these five communities: African Garden, Bedwood Garden, Goldsmith Villa, and Hermitage and Augustown. So we're going to plant Hermitage, where the first cultural day was kept by Professor Barry Shevins, Miss Lou, and Rana Williams. Not much people can say this, they know Miss Lou or Rana Williams. I can say that that's where she performed in Hermitage. Dean the man, Sangi Davis. Sangi Davis was the person who used to cook for Bob Marley. Sangi Davis was my neighbor. But can you imagine, you're the neighbor of Sangi Davis? So I was the guy that, can you imagine how many people can say they grate up, cook that for Bob Marley or cut up a piece of cabbage for Bob Marley to come and eat? Through Rudy's effort, we had a reggae Hermitage, and I never knew this. Sangi Davis, that what I'm saying, nobody will hear this because you can't download it because everybody tried to download information. So you got to send for Dean here in Africa, wherever you want to hear it again. But through Rudy's effort, that's what give him, in Jamaica, reggae, for most of you, you have to sing for your honor. You can't copyright a reggae artist. Lieutenant Stitchy, there's only one lieutenant. One Papa San. There's only one Brigadier Jerry. Mm-hmm. Rudy's new name as of today is Excellency Sir Honorable Rudy Page. That's his reggae name. Nobody can get that, and I give it to him.
Thank you.
So Reggae Hermitage is what is the hub of reggae music. As I can tell, that's where Sangi Davis wrote songs about Marley, you know. Bob would come there, Jimmy Cliff would come there. the former minister of opposition leader Peter Phillips. He would come and have his lunch right next to me, and he was a member of the 12 tribe of Israel. So Augusttown, which is our community surrounding Hermitage, it was first called African Mountain. And before African Mountain, Emancipation Day, 1830, 34, 38, that's when it gets its name, Augusttown. Mm-hmm. It's very spiritual. You heard about Bedward. Mm-hmm. Not much people can say the old Bible that Bedward used to use.
Yeah.
I touch Bedward Bible. I hold Bedward Bible. I open it. So I've been involved in community work from way back. You know, I can say that I'm one of the first person, maybe, and I don't want to say the first, but the earliest person to give Sizzler an award. Now, not much people can give an individual award to top artists. I give Muta Baruka. Muta Baruka come and show a film show in my community. When he came here, I gave him the Marcus Garvey Award. I gave Yellow Man an award. I gave Caperton an award. I gave Dwayne Stephen. But the reason why I do that, because when I was young, Bob Marley and all these people would come by me and we would not recognize them. You know, them said, "Sure, Bob, I'm nothing better to do." But when he got famous, I don't want to embrace him.
Yes.
You know, I don't do that with an organization.
Yeah.
I become the scout ambassador, so I got the governor, I get quite a few medals and awards in Jamaica, Medal of Merit. So I make sure to give them the ambassador's award as an individual. And they keep this committee and they say that you don't deserve it and all those things. So, you know, Cape Town came in hard for that. I make sure, because reggae music is not inherited or benefit by our young black, our people who really sing the reggae music. Some people that are talking about Bob Marley never even know Bob Marley. Okay. You know, Sangi Davis. A lot of people, when I mentioned Sangi Davis, they don't know who's Sangi Davis.
Mm.
Sangi Davis wrote 3-4 songs for Bob.
Yeah. Don't forget Zebedee.
And Zebedee was the guy that, can you imagine you're registering people to be a member of your organization and a guy comes, someone comes to you and you ask him, what's your name? And the guy says, my name is Bob Marley. And, you know, you registered Bob in the 12 tribe. And we need to recognize these small people. These people, you know, they are still alive.
Yeah, the stalwarts of the community.
Yeah, so what we're doing with Hermitage and Rudy now as a linkage is to export reggae.
We on Fresh FM, we broadcast a program called Kingston 7 Beats every month. So we take upcoming artists and established primarily from the Kingston 7 area, and then we broadcast the music every month, and then we share the music as well to other stakeholders as well. So we see that as being an important link back into Jamaica to provide that platform. So Dean, I'm gonna have to move on.
So one quick point with Diana, I just want to let you know before I leave, I need a plug to go in Hermitage with all of who is here. So we need our grandfather's signature from Africa. So there's the reggae tree. I'm going to guarantee it's going to be in Hermitage. But we don't want it to be in Hermitage. It's a very unusual community. So we need a signature from all of who is on the panel now to be on that plaque. So my plaque is not going to be a normal and a regular plaque. So people from all over the world is going to have to come and see that plaque.
Thanks for that. And linked to that, what we said as well, that what we should do for Jamaica's Diamond Jubilee next year, 60th anniversary, that we should have a reggae tree in all the areas around the country, because every parish, of course, every community has produced a reggae star. And, you know, so the whole idea of the reggae tree, And we're sort of twinning the trees and linking the parishes together through the reggae tree, all starting from Harleston's simple little tree. So again, you know, sometimes the smallest blade of grass, you know, as I say, from little acorns grow. So it's the symbolism, the fact that Harleston had the tree in the first place. And now it's, you know, it's it will blossom into something much bigger. And it's also about the environment, as was stated earlier on. Kwaku, you made a good point there, which I didn't know about. We'll bring more of that involved, because with the young people, and this is where the creative economy is so important, as we talk about the 21st century skills legacy, the creative economy, but we're also thinking about digital innovation. We're talking about thinking about sustainable engineering, which is about the environment. How do you recycle the things that are in your community that are of benefit to community, and how do you get young people involved? It's part of youth development. And the women in reggae is about women's empowerment as well, which is an integral part of, again, the International Decade for People of African Descent. The Sustainable Development Goals number 5 is about the empowerment of women. It's about education, you know, SDG 4, as it's called. So in all aspects, reggae can play a real, or reggae is a cornerstone or one of the pillars for improving our community's mental health and spiritual well-being. So I think what's being done here, and particularly in Harleston in this way, and Dean's up in Connecticut, so, you know, what started in Harleston is being translated around the reggae world and through our communities, you know, which is really great. And of course, reggae is very open as well, so it's not a closed, it's to the world, isn't it? It welcomes the world, it welcomes all people, as was mentioned before. Right, so Kwaku, I'm just wondering, could you say a bit about, because Colin Brown couldn't make it, the Reggae Fraternity UK, and just a bit about their background and, you know, what they do, as Colin wasn't able to make it.
Yeah, Reggae Fraternity is going for a while. What the founders, or what motivated the founders, including Colin, not just Colin, the few others, was the fact that reggae was very disparate, and they were doing man and man team on the road type things, and they needed some professionalism.
Yeah.
Up to now, Colin particularly has got an issue with people who are not engaging with technology like streaming. People are still doing their vinyl, and yeah, respect for vinyl. As you know, Children has just released a 50th anniversary edition of a 3 LP compilation that came out 50 years ago. So people still buy vinyl. I appreciate it. People are still buying new record players. Understand it. But the industry, by and large, is moving towards the digital age. And for my man to be just satisfied, just pressing a few vinyl and trying to make a living, that's almost impossible.
Yeah.
So these are the ideas that Reggae Fraternity had, to professionalize the reggae community. Its website is a hub. It promotes events that are coming. It points people as to activities happening in the music industry. Because what's going to happen is that, yeah, you're going to press your record and you're going to make money from those that you sold. But that's a small part of the pie. There is a potential to, in fact, some of our records have been played on radio. They're not being, and people are not making money out of it. Because what they don't realize is that if you're not on a collection society's database, they don't know you. They're not going to come chasing you and say, Mr. John, here's some money we owe you. People are not getting involved in the industry side. We hear things like, let's set up our own. Well, you're welcome to set up a parallel thing. But until then, feed into what is taking your money. Because the only organization that BBC is going to pay for public performance is one company called PRS.
Yeah.
So until yours is established, that money, your including your money, goes to PRS. So these are the things that Reggae Fraternity is trying to do, to sensitize the community. That is an industry.
And that is
why they're one of the main supporters of International Reggae Day. Because, in fact, they've got a bigger vision of International Reggae Day. They want International Reggae Day to be the hub, i.e. the key confab for the community in terms of networking. And when we had Goldsmiths University, that was fantastic because we had a lot of space, and that day we had Trojan, we had so many independents, some musicians union. People could have free stalls to sort of have meet and greet.
Yeah, no,
eyeball to eyeball. So that is what Reggae Fraternity is about.
Great. So hopefully you'll be back, or we'll all be back with you in Goldsmiths next year.
By God's grace, once pandemic is over, definitely.
Excellent. We've got a great support.
Oh, the other thing one needs to say.
Yeah.
Often we see these organizations, and we're a bit, what should I say, disengaged, or we say, yeah, we should be everywhere. It's not just a matter of being everywhere. It's having conscious people being in those systems.
Exactly.
How do we get into Goldsmiths? Because there's a professor there called Julian Enrique,
okay,
who is into reggae. Himself has been doing the part of the SS, Sound System International.
Yes.
So he understands reggae. So yeah, it was a no-brainer for International Reggae Day to go to that
space. He knows the culture. Excellent. And that commitment to the culture, which is really important. So we look forward to next year being fantastic because, you know, Jamaica 60, Diamond Jubilee, you know, and as I said, the sound system for me is so important. So we definitely, from Fresh FM Radio London, will make sure that we support everything continually. Right, just before we close, is there any last points anybody wants to make?
There's Patricia who's joined us.
Right, maybe okay.
Maybe you might want her to say a word. She's a Houston singer.
Okay, Patricia.
If you mind saying so.
Okay, Patricia, the floor's yours.
Rudy, whilst Patricia, we need to hear her speak. Can I just join together a couple of things, if you don't mind?
Yeah.
Okay. Somebody mentioned Jetstar. Jetstar was started by three brothers called the Palmer Brothers. The last brother was Carl. And Carl, you see why we should document our things? Carl was very media shy. I knew him personally. I can talk to him. I go into Jetstar. He gave me a lot of CDs, particularly coming to Ghana. And say, take it and give it to people in Ghana. I was that kind of person. But Mr. Palmer won't let me interview him. Luckily, he did something at the Jamaican High Commission. And I did something called, I forgot what project it was. By the way, I've done some of these projects. I think it was the Bren Black Music History. Yeah, I did a DVD and a booklet called Bren Black Music History. And I captured just a segment of him. And what he was saying was that he was, so this links in with Fizra about sound system people. He was saying, whilst people are going, working the factories or whatever, and bringing money on the table for the wives to buy food and put food on the table, sound system men spend their money buying fresh biscuits. If the wives do not get the money from the sound system men, they just spend the money on records. You know, they're so crazy about records. So I just wanted to give a respect to Mr. Palmer, who I believe is alive, though it's not in the UK. It may be in Jamaica or Nigeria. Mm. But Fizra, this is a question to you. I interviewed the son, Andrew, the son of Fat Man. And obviously, he's picked up Fat Man's sound. So you have to tell me how big they are. Now, Donna, you say you just heard about the reggae tree. I'm glad you've heard about it. But is there purposely, Houston, we claim, is the capital of reggae in Britain. It could be nowhere else but in Houston. And it's great that it's in front of two record shops that are still going over 40 years old. If you knew Houston in the 70s, there were a whole lot of record shops from Church End.
Yes.
To the high street, they've all gone, but two are standing, which is Hawkeye. So the record shop is directly in front of Hawkeye, but across the street is also, what is the record shop? That name has gone out of my head.
Starlight.
Popsy's shop. Now, Antoinette, I think I remember you now. We communicated about Yeza. Now that you mention your artist, we communicated a few years up about Yeza. Fantastic artist. So I think I've done my spiel. Thank you very much, Rudy.
Rudy, can I just come in there?
Yes.
You're talking about the Palmers, right?
Palmer Brothers, yes.
Yeah. I'm the last resident DJ for London Apollo. I played London Apollo the last 30 years.
Look at that.
Wow.
I take home Jeffrey Palmer every night for the last 15 years. It's me that take him home. So I know Jeffrey Palmer very well.
Yeah.
Okay, then can I just plug something?
And they're all the same. They don't do interviews. That's the brothers.
Okay.
They don't talk to people. That's
you're right. I said, I know him personally, but he's still, we can talk for hours, but he won't let me interview him personally. Can I just say something on London Apollo? Because I had the honor of doing the playlist my first time. In fact, I'm gradually getting into streaming. And I have to say, I'm finding things like, what is it, Spotify, fantastic, because I don't have access to my CDs. So that's been fantastic. So I did a playlist, and it's called BritishBlackMusic.com, Black Music Congress Presents Trojan. Good. And then I did an article. So if you find it online, you can read it. I did a personal liner notes. And what I saw was that it's from a non-anorak. Although I do things around reggae, I'm not claiming to be an anorak. So yeah. I talk about how I was in Ghana in the 60s, hearing the first reggae tracks. But I said, I wasn't one of the people that went to the reggae shops and waited hours to buy records. I was not one of the people that was in the clubs trying to rub the wallpaper or whatever. My only experience in the London Apollo was only once.
Wasn't when
a reggae, I had two cousins. One was a soul head, which I gravitate towards. And the other cousin was a reggae head. So he was the one that took me to London Apollo for once. I remember us walking, I must be 4 a.m. No, in those days, you know, they didn't have these late night passes like you do now. Yeah. So that was my recollection of the real London Apollo in the heydays.
And I think, again, when we talk about the sound systems, we'll come back to the clubs, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And the pubs that we all used to go to. Patricia, over to you.
Hi there. Hi. Yeah, I just came in at the last minute, really. Do you know what? I grew up I grew up in the church. So I've always sang from a very young age. I directed a choir from when I was about 20. There was about 50 young people within the choir. So it hasn't actually been a reggae background. But I did, funnily enough, do a reggae track with the Palmers, one of the brothers. We went in the studio and recorded a song. We were quite young. And the song was called I for Jesus, You for Jesus, Come to Jesus. You probably never heard of it before. So I could sing a track of it. Yeah, how did it go again? God, it's been such a long time ago now.
So, Patricia, are you going to re-release it?
Oh, good question. I think I've got the vinyl somewhere, actually.
There you go.
Get in the studio. I can find it.
But
I was just on the phone to my daughter because she actually has a music background as well. And as I was talking, listening to you guys, there's a song that she recorded when she was 17. She's now 27. And it's on Amazon and on iTunes. And I thought, my God, this song would be so powerful for now. And it's a song called Unbreakable. And it's a reggae track as well. So I was just on the phone to her now, just figuring how could we, do you know what I mean, get that, you know, exposed.
Get it onto YouTube, share the link everywhere.
Yeah, that's what I was just on the phone to her now, because the words are so just for now, just so incredible.
Is it a cover with you guys? An original or a cover
it's
song?
It's her original song. She's only got her own songs on iTunes. Okay. But this particular one she did was a reggae song. So in regards to myself, I think I've got about maybe most of my songs are like R&B, but there's two particular songs which are a reggae influence as well. So I'm versatile. Like I do all genres when necessary. So
that's
me in a nutshell.
Great to hear from you. Diane.
Rudy. Hi, I was going to... Sorry, I got... My battery went, so do... Yeah, so I got lost somewhere. Okay. it's lovely to have Pat on here as well. But I was going to say, just rewinding a bit, Apollo. So my late dad, I remember... So Apollo nightclub... I went in, my dad took me in, I must have been about 14, just to go in and meet Mr. Palmer. And then my first time I ever went to Apollo was with my cousin and my nephew's mum. And it's just having those beautiful memories, now that my mum and dad are no longer here. And then going on to, so each year, my little treat, or my dad's treat to me, he used to take me to Jetstar to get records. I used to come out of a box, Mr. Palmer never used to chart, just used to have to choose my records as a cover. That's so my late husband now as well. So I remember before I started going dating, Ray, the Sound Clash. Yeah. We had a sound clash and I dropped some tunes on him because I dropped some tunes on him. I kept on saying to him, I know I beat you. And he's no longer here now. So we never got to do part two. Even after we got married, I always used to say to him, yeah, let's have another sound clash. But I say to his friends, come on, bring it on. But I don't, no one's kind of taking me on.
Right.
Yeah, I know tunes. I used to bring.
And so we're looking forward to you and Fitz.
I won't take Big Brother. But I used to bring music back from Jamaica. My dad used to take me to, because my dad was well connected in Jamaica as well. So we used to go to studios, the Dynamic Studios, and I used to bring back vinyls. So my brother has got some of those music, and my mum, when she came here before I was born, Trojan Records. My mum used to buy music as well. So, I can't get away from music. So I give thanks to my mum and dad. My husband was a sound system man as well. He was a mic man as well. So, I look forward to that conversation.
Yeah, that's going to be a great dialogue, that one. Really is, those memories. Right, Dean, we've got to close, but I'm going to give you the last word as you're the foreigner in USA.
Well, as I said, I'm not a member of the team, but I just want to thank you for having me. And there's a lot of project that we have in the Hermitage community for the young people, because what I'm doing, I'm just a messenger trying to prolong the message or the work that we all are doing. And we have to bring our young people, a lot of people keep it and becomes gatekeeper. And myself and Rudy is all about connection. I'm an action guy, and I don't make promises, and I'm out there with young people there in the community through music. I'm very proud to say, even now, that we have people from the bobsled team. They were going to the Olympics. We have gymnastic team.
Yeah.
For the gymnastics, he's from Hermitage. Simone Edwards, the basketball, the national basketball coach. She was born, she was living in my house. So, as I said, time would not permit us. And these are not fly-by-night people. These are people who are representing Jamaica at the highest level. I just came on the phone with Jimmy Sinclair like 2 weeks ago, the first reggae boy. But the bottom line, I need help right now.
And right. I support. Okay.
So I just like to see them. Thank you very much, Rudy, for His Excellency, Sir Honorable Rudy Page. Reggae this is the Scout Ambassador officially. Anoint Rudy Page reggae name. Okay, you gotta take a name so nobody get that name.
Okay.
It's all right. The two words is fine. Two words, Rudy Page is fine.
I have been to a lot of march pass. As a scout leader, I have been to the IS. We have been to march pass. I was appointed to train policemen around the island of Jamaica, top scouts in America. So this appointment is not like a fly by night.
Okay, that can be another program as well.
Rudy, sorry, can I just make a little request?
Yeah.
You got two beautiful singers on here. Just a quick line.
Let them sing.
Yeah, the two beautiful singers.
Have you got the words? Welcome to Harleston, the home of reggae.
What was coming to me is, welcome to Harleston, the home of reggae.
Excellent. So, Donna, there you go. Yeah.
Welcome to Harleston, the home of reggae.
Right. Now, both together, finale.
Welcome to
Harleston, the home of reggae.
Right. Yeah. Okay, let's go again. One, two, three.
Welcome to Harleston, the home of reggae.
Different timing.
Donna, do yours.
Welcome to Harleston, the home of reggae.
Thank you. Patricia?
Do you want me to do the harmony or sing the same thing?
No, just do the same thing.
Okay. Welcome to Harleston, the home of reggae.
Very good.
Thank you both.
Wait. While you're there, Just tell me if you can just add Hermitage now. You know, the so just do that one for me. Just seize the moment, man. I want to hear you guys sound so good. I want to hear all you get. Put the ice in it.
Welcome to Hermitage, the home of reggae. Is that it?
Beautiful. Do it again, Patricia.
Welcome to Hermitage, the home of reggae.
Excellent. That's going to be all over Jamaica now.
Yeah. First of all, to you, I wanted you to tell me about Zebedee, because you mentioned the Azumi that we know. Also, Donna hadn't said much, but at least she talked about her parents. She talked about the Marvels. So can you tell us a bit, because they are key in reggae. And then, that is it. Oh, then Fizz, I said you have to tell me how good Fatman was. Fatman actually used to play at 31 Club. Yeah. And also the Apollo. So although they are North London crew, they used to come to us. And so those are the three things I want from you.
Can you just say a bit more about Zebedee?
Oh, Zebedee, I could, give me your contact and I'll get you to get him straight. But Zebedee was the person, he was a secretary for the 12th tribe. Mm-hmm. So the 12th tribe of Israel is a part, like it's a religion in Jamaica. So you have the Naya Bingi, the Baba Shanti. So most of these artists, so once he becomes a member, so I know the secretary for this 12th tribe, the present one. So at that time when Bob Marley, Rita Marley, they came with Alan Skillcole to join the 12th tribe. It was Zebedee that was the person doing the registration. Zebedee was a guy when Bob Marley, through all of his ups and downs, his tragedy, most of the things that happened to him, he would go to show with Bob Marley to Africa, all over the world, because he was a secretary. So he was very close to Bob Marley. And he's somebody I talked to on a regular basis.
Okay.
Sankey Davis was a cook. He cooks for all. So all the Rastaman that used to eat Eitel, because Bob, they eat a special type of food. Now, what we are eating now, very expensive. That is what the 12th tribe grew up on. As Muta Baruka would say, run down your food. You must clip it. It is moving away from you now. They call it fast food. But, okay. They don't use salt. So all the people would come buy meat, buy sangit to have. So all those famous people, once you was a Rastaman in Jamaica, that's where you would come and have your little box lunch. So sangit the person that cook it.
Thanks for that.
Fitzroy, Fatman, what were you going to say about Fatman?
Well, Fatman was there. He's the dad is one of the icons, you know what I mean? It's proper. When you know that, when Fatman was coming to Apollo, you'd know. You know what I mean? You'd know. Because the people there would be there. The people that you ain't seen them for a while, but they come in there because Fatman was coming there. His son is running in the set now. And yeah, he's doing okay still. He's upholding the name because it's a big name to carry still.
Yeah.
But yeah, Fatman was proper up there.
Can I ask your permission? Just
very quickly related to what Fitz is saying. And of course, so Fatman for years, played at the African Cultural Center up in Haringey.
Yeah.
Of course, they were featured in the Windrush film as well, as that was one of the places where the gentleman went to listen to Fatman. All for his troubles as it related to the Windrush scandal. So again, you can see how reggae just, it's seamless through our lives, But
Fitzroy, can I have your permission to use just that little contribution you did on Fatman?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. Rudy, if you can sort it out for me, I appreciate it.
Yeah, we'll do. Donna,
thanks.
Time is really against me.
Okay. Tell us a bit about the Marvels, quickly.
I'll try and make it sweet and short. I've got so much to say. I'm just bursting with excitement. But basically, I grew up in a musical family. Early memories was probably North Circular Road, not far from Harlesden. I grew up in the Marvels. My father was Dimples, Alexander Hines, and my mom, Ornelle Hines. And at the time, it was Eddie Smith that was in the Marvels. And, there was lots of rehearsals in my house and microphones everywhere, music,
harmonizing. It was just such a lovely vibe, you know, music all the time. There were times when mum was in the kitchen cooking rice and peas, dad was singing. If they weren't singing together, there was always music playing, R&B, and it was just a lovely environment to grow up in. And I never really said much at the time. I was a quiet child, seen and not heard at the time. That's how it was. And I'm very disciplined, but I would always put my little harmony in without them hearing me, you know, my little oohs and my ahs. Ooh, ah. You know, constantly putting my oohs and ahs in without saying anything. And then when I did come out now and start singing, my dad said, hey, she have a voice. And that's where it all started, you know. I became, well, I was always Donna Hines, but, you know, I became a singer myself. And Dandy Livingstone recorded me. And at an early age, I went to a studio called Delaney in Wembley. And working alongside a lady called Nanette, what was her name? Nanette Human? Yeah, at the studio in Wembley. And I recorded my first song when I was about 9 years old. And I've been singing ever since. I think I came out singing. So I've been singing ever since. And at the moment, I'm working with Junior English. And, you know, a couple of years ago, I think, well, what was it, 2018, I had a really hard time. You know, my father passed away. And 6 months later, I lost my partner. So it's a bit like Diane. And I've just gone from strength to strength. I've realized now, you know, that we all have to pass one day. And I'm just singing my way. I'm just singing my way to stardom, really. I mean, that's all I can do. Music is a part of my life. It's in my blood. It's in my veins. So that's it in a nutshell.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We're certainly going to revisit all that again as well in the future. Yes. We really are.
I have a tune out now, single. It's called Call Me by Donna Hines. And you can find it on YouTube. It was released on January the 31st. So hopefully it's playing all over the airwaves.
Yeah, well, send it into Fresh FM and we will feature it.
I will. And then the follow-up is coming, I think, in a couple of weeks' time. Yeah, so there's some cultural stuff as well. So I'll send it all into you.
Yeah? Please, because as we said, we're committed to women in reggae.
No problem.
Right. Quaker, did you want to say something before I come to Dean?
Lovely meeting you.
Yeah.
So much about you. It's just lovely to have met you and be on the platform.
Okay. I just want to say this to you, Donna, before you go, is that I wasn't aware of the Marvel, certainly not a brand connection. I did a booklet called Brand Black Music History, and as part of London Barrow of Culture, it was adapted and augmented. It's now called the A to Z Encyclopedia of Brand Black Music, but I'm definitely going to upgrade that and make sure that the Marvels and yourself included in there.
Yeah, right. That's great. And actually, Donald, before you go, of course, we must mention Sonny Roberts' Aldercone Records, who passed recently.
Yeah.
who I got to know very well. Yeah. Used to meet him in Jamaica with his wife and family, his daughter Cleon Roberts.
Yeah, my uncle.
Very well. My uncle. Really?
Yeah. Sonny Roberts. I worked very closely with him in my teenage years, you know?
Because
family related, you know, he's my uncle. My mum is to call his wife auntie, so
excellent. Yeah, I know the family quite well, and we're doing a special feature on Sonny Roberts 1st of July as well, special tribute as part of National Reggae Day as well.
Say that we had the opportunity of giving him a British Black Music Award. We gave the same to Lee Gupto and Chris Blackwell, and he informed Chris Blackwell because he was in Jamaica. Mm-hmm. I know Sonny quite well, and what I say is that Sonny was one of the lucky ones, because you know a lot of people came from the Caribbean hoping to go back and they never did. Yes. Some are ended up in Cancer Rise Cemetery. Yeah. He was one of the few that ended up going back, and he had a great life. Back, I think he was planting.
Yeah, I went to his farm in Manchester.
Peppers and things like that. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, and he's featured in the Brand Black Music History Project. You can be sure.
Donna, was he going to say something?
No. I was just saying. Yeah, I'm related to him, and his wife and his my cousins. You know, their children are my cousins.
Right.
And I was going to say, Mr. Palmer's my godfather as well, to top it all off.
Look at that.
Wow.
Real family.
Which one of the Palmer brothers? Carl?
The one that was, Carl.
Carl. It must be Carl then.
Okay. Yeah, Mr. Yeah,
Palmer.
Carl, yeah.
Mr. Palmer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, yeah. Okay. And, you know, being the Hinds, I think I've got a lot of relatives in the music business as well. I mean, one of them in the Abyssinians.
Yes.
And, practically all the Hinds, really. Everyone who's Hinds, like Horace Andy, all the Hinds.
There's lots of musical legacy there.
Definitely.
Just for a few seconds. So Donna's dad and my mum and dad grew up on Maxfield Avenue together. When I was going to bury my mum and dad, the plot, joy came to my heart because I saw Dimple's grave right there. So they're all buried very, very close to one another. My husband, Dimple's, is in the middle, and then my mum and dad a bit further on.
We all know each other and we're in the same place right now.
Diane's father was a good friend of mine. I really enjoyed chatting to him. Sitting in the taxi office there.
Wow.
Great. All right, everyone. Thank you very much. It's been great reminiscing. Also, we've been thinking about the future as well, which is important.
Thank you.
And we're about collaboration, which was our key theme for this platform. And I really do look forward to some of the future dialogues that will be coming up. Now, we've got events for the rest of the year under the Reggae Global and Culture theme. So August, we'll be doing something. So we'll definitely do a platform in August. And, of course, October, Black History Month, we'll do something there. So we'll have another two sessions at least for the rest of the year. All right. So on that great note, thank you all very much.
Thank you.
And take care.